Have you ever had one of those moments when you realize something that was life-changing? I mean, these things can be small, they can be big. You know, it could be like, hey, I'm scrolling through Facebook this day or Instagram, and all of a sudden I see this little hack that helps, like something that used to take forever, now doesn't take very long, right? Or it can even be like you learn something new. And because you learned something new, that made life a little bit different. Or maybe you've had one of those experiences this week where like a big thing happened and it became something that was incredibly life-changing. And so you're stuck in this moment of like, okay, what does this mean? What does this do? And really in those moments, especially in the bigger things in life, it really gives us a different perspective, right? Helps us see things different, helps us look at the way we're living and go, okay, am I really doing what I need to be doing? Am I doing it the right way? Is this the right thing to do? And so like we're left at this place of going, okay, I now know something. This thing has potential to really change my life. What am I going to do with it? The other thing we see in a lot of those moments is when things happen, we see how it not only gives perspective, but it also brings into like what's really important and what's not important, right? So some changes need to be made, and when changes need to be made, really you got to ask that question of like, is this really worth holding on to, or is it ultimately going to do something to me that's going to be detrimental? And so now I've got to make this decision. You see, a lot of times in these moments, it's the moments when we realize what really matters and how much they really matter. Today what we're going to do is we're going to look at, as we know from the Christmas story, the three wise men, right? And in Matthew chapter 2, it starts out by introducing us to these wise men. It says, Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea. And during the reign of King Herod, about that time, some wise men from the eastern lands arrived in Jerusalem asking, where is the newborn king of the Jews? We saw his star as it rose, and we have come to worship him. Right? We have come to worship him. We see two things that we see immediately from this, and this is really where we want to focus on today. They came with two things that they wanted to do. They came to worship, and they came to give. They came to worship, and they came to give. One of the things that I love about our church is simply this fact, and this has been something that's been at the core of who we are from the very beginning of this church, which started in January of 2016, was one of our values, and one of the things that we really get, we've not just had this aspiration to have, but it's been something that's been there from the beginning. It's just this thing that says, hey, we want to give our best. Like, it's been one of the values that has been championed from the early times and the original crew that helped start. And so that means, to me though, that means so much more. When we talk about a church that gives our best, sometimes we automatically go to the whole idea of money. And yes, that was part of it. Like, we had people that sacrificed and gave so that we could do and buy and get all the stuff that we needed to launch and to get things going. But we had more. What was more impressive is just how much like people put into it, like with their time and their talents. And it was amazing to see from the very beginning of this thing, from the very outset, like this became not just something that's aspirational, but this became who we are as a church. And we continue to see it year in and year out. Even through the times where it's been up and down and hard and we've made moves or COVID's happened and then we get shut down and all these things begin to go, it's still amazing to see how God just continues to stir up that thing in each and every one of us that says, hey, my desire is to give my best. You see, one of the stories that we go to often when we talk about this idea of giving our best is a story that the gospel writers tell about this woman who came into a meeting one day when Jesus was meeting with some other people, and she came in and she was a sinner, and these people were looking at her like, you don't belong here, right? And it says that she went to Jesus, and it said she didn't go and have this conversation. It says that she went and she fell at his feet. And when she fell at his feet, she took this bottle of perfume that she had, and it said that she poured it all out at Jesus' feet. And it was this beautiful picture. Can you imagine the aroma that kind of filled the room that day? And what's amazing about this is it doesn't say she poured out half of it. She said she emptied it. She poured out every last drop. She wanted to make sure she gave everything she had. She gave, as some would say, she gave her whole inheritance in that moment. And it was just this beautiful picture of this extravagant worship and this expressive worship and this extravagant generosity. You see, as a church, our heart has been from the very beginning that we worship and we are generous. And here's what's interesting about Christmas. If Christmas is all about Jesus, right, then it calls into account our worship and our generosity. You see, the Magi were interesting people, or wise men, whatever you want to call them, right? But when you read this story, we got to ask a couple questions. Who are they? And how did they know? And what's interesting as you dig into this, what you see is you see somebody that's really committed to what they set out to do. Like they set out, remember, to worship and to what? Okay, we got to remember this. Set out to worship and to what? Give. And so they were committed to this, so committed that they made an 800 to 900 mile journey just to get there. Round trip. Just to go worship Jesus and give gifts. Okay? Now, real quickly, I know for Christmas, some of us have to travel. Some of us go different places at Christmas. Like for us, we load up the car and we head to Rockford, Illinois almost every year. And so, like, we've done that for, since Katie and I started dating. Okay? And so we know that in order for us to get to Christmas, it's going to take us about 5 to who knows how long, depending on what Chicago's like, to get to Rockford, Illinois. And we know that at that place, we're going to get gifts. We're going to give gifts. We're going to get to be with family. It's going to be a good time. We're going to gain a few pounds. How many of you have ever been to those houses where you just know when you walk in, you're going to gain weight? You don't even have to eat there. Just that's the way it works. You go there and you know the different things that are going to happen. And you're committed to this. You're committed to making this journey, because you know what's on the other side. And so these Magi were committed to this journey. But the difference about this journey is that they were going off of just some ancient prophecies. They were going off what they read and what they heard, but also they were also going off of what they see. And the last service was interesting because I asked people, I said, hey, how many of you travel for Christmas and who travels the longest distance? And so in this room, is anybody going further than Rock 5 hours? Anybody? Okay, Courtney, how far are you going? Florida. So that's a ways, okay? She was in the last service and said, I'm not going to say it because the guy said Montana. So she's like, I lost. But do you see, so like you're committed. There's different things. And so different people travel different places and there's a cost to it, right? Like, especially if you're driving right now, there's a cost to it. Now, if you're as good as like Janelle Garno, you get tickets for like $30 and somehow you magically fly there for cheaper than you could drive. I don't know. But like, it's true, isn't it? See? And everybody needs travel advice. You just go ask her. No, sorry. But there's a journey. There was a commitment to this journey. And so much so, not just in the miles that they put in, but also the time in what they put in. They said that the journey alone, the commitment to the journey was a 6 to 12 month commitment. Like, we don't know much about the wise men or the Magi. We know a little bit, but we don't know what their family situations are or what they were leaving and all this stuff. But to do anything for 6 to 12 months, like, you got to be committed, right? Like, it's easy to go like, okay, I'm going to commit to going to my in-laws' house for like 3 days. Like, to go there for 6 months, that might be a stretch. You get to a week and 2 weeks, it might be even bigger. Like, it just, you know what I'm saying, right? But the commitment to just say, hey, we're committed to this. And their commitment was all for the reason of coming to worship Jesus and to give him gifts. But the second part of this question is simply this. How did they know? It says they saw the star, and they saw that it rose, but how did they even understand this? Well, we got to go back about 500 years in history, when you look at where it came from. And what's interesting is this exact area in which these three men would have come from was the area in which Daniel was in exile. And during the time that Daniel was in exile, he wrote a bunch of prophecies. And one of the prophecies he wrote was about Jesus and when he would come and where he would come and the signs to look for when he would come. And so while they were there, they were studying, or like they would study the prophecies and the things that Daniel wrote. You see, but they also didn't just study them. They saw the star and they knew. Now here's what's interesting about this. So you got to understand, this is 500 years removed from Jesus coming to this earth. So, like, these things had to be handed down from generation to generation, story told from generation to generation, in order for that this prophecy to be fulfilled. And not only was that, they had to be looking for it. I don't know about you, have you guys just went out in this outside lately and just stared at the stars and waited to see if anything was going to happen? Like, it's not something you do. Now, these men were known for, they would look at the stars. They were astrologers almost, right? And so that was part of who they were. But for most of us, like, even though we read some things, we don't always go and do what they say. And so oftentimes we might have missed it. Well, they didn't miss it. They didn't miss it, and they knew that they had to go and they had to see what Daniel had prophesied about. So they took this whole thing to another level, right? They packed up their best gifts and what they needed for the journey, and they left out to find the one that Daniel had prophesied about. They said, we have to go, and we have to worship, and we have to give. And who? They had to worship Jesus. The prophecies, all about Jesus. The star in the sky, all about Jesus. The place where he was going to be born, all about Jesus. The journey was all about Jesus. The gifts, all about Jesus. I mean, it's fun when people really know you and they give you gifts, like, you know, they know that you'll love, right? Anybody else like that? Like, leave the socks and underwear, give me something that I actually enjoy, right? But it's amazing that even as you read, and we're going to talk about this in the coming weeks, like the gifts and the significance behind the gifts. So they knew what the significance of that gift that they were bringing. They were bringing it with a specific idea in mind, and that was to worship and to give this gift to Jesus. You see, this Christmas, we want to help you recapture the meaning of Christmas. And so in order to recapture the meaning of Christmas, we have to ask a serious question, is what things about Christmas or during Christmas season have become familiar to you? What are the things that have just become routine? Because I know as my kids get older, it's kind of become a little bit of a routine. Like, we know that we're going to do this. We know that they're going to send us stuff that they want on their Christmas list. We know that we're going to get up and on Christmas morning and we're going to be at Katie's parents and we're going to do Christmas that way, and it just becomes familiar. And we know, like, the routine. And it's so easy in the middle of the familiar to miss kind of what God is wanting to do. It's kind of easy during the familiar to kind of lose joy. Because I got to tell you, and if you're a parent and you have older kids, you get this, like, Christmas is different when they're 16 and 21 and 23 compared to when they're 8, right? The excitement of, like, last time Zeke opened a gift, he didn't go, oh, right? He's like, yeah, I knew I was getting this, right? Like, that's the way it is. But Hadley opened it, and it's like joy. I mean, it's like everything's joyful, right? But it's different. Like, to them, it's become a part of the routine. It's expected. Like, this is what's expected. This is what we do. And so in order to really recapture what Christmas is about, we have to look at the things that have become so familiar. It was interesting because, you know, the guy that lives in Montana, he was saying, I was thinking about this between services. It's like, how many have ever just, like, driven through the mountains, or, like, found a cottage or a cabin in the mountains and just kind of stayed there and enjoyed the beauty, right? Like, I'm kind of jealous of the people that kind of live in those spaces where they get to see this all the time. But what's interesting is, to those people, it's just become what? Familiar. It's just the landscape. It's just what they're used to. But for us that live in flatland, like, any hill and any mountain and anything that is an old garbage dump can now be a ski hill. And like, it's exciting, right? So there's some topography to this thing. So it's good. But it's amazing how even the little things can become really familiar and we lose the impact of them. Or we lose the awe and wonder of, as you're staring at this mountain and thinking about the one who created it, one who spoke it into existence. You see, Christmas is about Jesus. So if Christmas is about Jesus, then we got to understand that this journey that we're on, this Christmas, has a little bit different perspective as we look at the life or the story of the Magi. The story of the Magi, what we see is the journey of generosity begins with a heart of gratitude. They were looking for it. They were expecting it. They kept reading the story over and over again. They kept looking into the stars to see if this might be the day that they come. And so in this place, once they saw it, their hearts began, they had this, like they were grateful for it. And so they did everything they could. They said, we've got to pack it up. We've got to get the best gifts and we've got to go. And we've got to go for this reason, to worship and to give. You see, I don't know about you, but I think gratitude has been lost a little bit. And when I say this, I'm saying this to myself as well. I so easily could get to this place of not being grateful, even for the little things, but more importantly, even for the big things. And see, in our culture, we fight against this quite often because our culture tells us a couple things. Our culture tells us, if I had blank, then I would be grateful, right? If I just had that, you name it, you've got the Christmas list, you've been talking about it, then I'll have more joy and I'll be grateful. And yet, what's interesting is that's the opposite of what Jesus said. Jesus said, it's more blessed to give than to what? Receive. Jesus also, or James, Jesus' brother, said it this way. He said, every good action and every perfect gift is from who? God. And these good gifts come down from the creator of the sun, the moon, and stars, who what? That's a key one. Who does not change like the shifting of the shadows. If there's a message, if there is something that we need to continue to champion in this culture in which we live right now, is we serve a God who does not change. And for some people, that might be a little like offsetting, because like, no, he needs to change. Because look at how much we've changed. And so if we've changed, then he needs to change. Like, it's got to be this give and take. And God goes, no. I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. Like, I do not change. And let's be honest, there's some comfort in things not changing. Right? But there's also some comfort when things do change. Like, and we see things begin to contraction. But what we've got to see is we serve a God who does not change. And today, what we need to understand is simply this, like the journey of generosity begins with this heart of gratitude, understanding that every good and perfect gift comes from Him. That there's nothing that we can say, if I had this, then this would happen. Like, that is a selfish statement. That is a statement that says, I know what's best for me, and so if you just give me what's best for me, then I'll be happy. And I can tell you this, I've watched a lot of people when they get what they want, and it doesn't make them any happier. If anything, it makes them even more greedy. And then they want the next thing, and then the next thing. And yet they find themselves on this path and on this journey where they end up to a place where like, yeah, I still am not happy. Because what? They're looking for in all the external things. They're trying to find it in the things around them instead of what God is wanting to do in them and through them. We've talked about this over the last few weeks when we talked through this Thanksgiving series and we talked about peace and wanting peace. So when Jesus came, he'd be the Prince of Peace, right? The good news is a good news of peace. And peace is the presence of someone, right? And so it's the presence of Jesus. And even though we don't understand all the time why we don't get what we want, like we get to just trust that God is the one who gives exactly what we need because He's a God who gives good and perfect gifts and He doesn't change. So, gratitude, gratefulness, it's hard. And to be honest with you, times I'm not really good at it. But each and every one of us have an opportunity each and every day to start each and every day with a grateful heart. And I think it starts where James says, it's realizing that every good and perfect gift comes from Him. Can we start each day being grateful for all the things that we have in life? Real quick, what are you grateful for? Just shout them out. Well, everybody did it once. Good job. Your family, what else? Huh? Your mom? Man, what Christmas gift do you want? Okay. What else? Warm weather. Nicole's like, get me back to Florida quickly, right? What else? Health. What else? Huh? Jesus. Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm talking about, right? So, what else? Work. Yep. Faith. Yeah, it's grace. Yep. God's Word. Beautiful, right? God's forgiveness. Yeah. And so we rest. Yeah. Need more of it. But yes, we get that. You see, this week I had some things that kind of happened and kind of put a lot of things in perspective, even for my own life. The choices I'm making, the things that I'm grateful for, the things that I carry that I shouldn't be carrying, the weight that I have because of things I shouldn't be carrying. And it kind of put this thing in perspective to go, hey, like, what needs to go and what needs to stay? Because there's a lot of things that I've added to my life that have added things to my life, right? That I don't want, and then the side effects are worse because of it. And so, like, if there's ever a perfect message to what we talked about last week, it's this need for rest. And that need for rest, we said from last week, we said it's in the invitation. It's just us accepting the invitation. It's in us accepting the gift. Because what's interesting is the journey of generosity is also fueled by love. And there's no greater love than what God has given to you and I. Best Christmas verse is simply this one. For God so loved the world that He what? He gave. And He gave His one and only Son that whoever believes in Him shall not perish but have eternal life. But you know what's interesting about love? Love costs. Or put it this way. Love is always expressed through sacrificial generosity. God expressed His love. He gave His Son. He gave the best gift that He could give to you and I. But the fact of the matter is you and I, we have a choice. And we can either accept or reject that gift. And that gift is ultimately His love. And God knows that. God doesn't sit there and go, oh, I'm going to force you to love me. I'm going to force you to do this. No, you have a choice. And you can continue to live the way you're living, or you can go, okay, God, I want to live your way. I want to follow you all the days of my life. And that's through the gift that God gave us through His Son, Jesus Christ. Because love is always expressed through sacrificial giving. He showed us what it looked like. He gave us the best gift that He could give us, one that was going to cost Him the most. And you and I are sitting here in this season going, what is Christmas about? It's about the greatest gift that God ever gave to you and I. It's Jesus. As we end this year, we get prepared for whatever 2023 is going to look like and all the things that are going to come with it. Like, my hope is that we can follow the lead of the wise men. Like, we can open up His Word, and we can listen to His voice, and we can live in His grace, and we can enjoy all these things that we have because of what Christ has given to us, right? And then we can follow His lead and go, I need to worship. And I need to give. Because Jesus means everything to me. Without Him, I wouldn't be who I am or where I am right now. Everything is about Jesus. The wise men teach us. It's about expressive worship. It's about extravagant generosity. And here's the thing we got to understand. It's going to cost you something. There's going to be a commitment involved to this. They didn't just jump on Delta Airlines and fly over and do this. No, they traveled by foot or by animal for hours and hours and hours. And I bet on this journey, they probably went, are we really doing this? Like, my guess is, like, as you got into the journey, at least if they're like me, you get into the journey a little bit and you're like, wow, my back's hurting already. Tailbone hurts. Like, we really doing this? I still got how many? Like, it was a commitment. There was a sacrifice. But it's a picture for you and I that go, man, when you truly know who Jesus is, when you truly discover who He is, your expression is going to be worship. And your response is going to be extravagant generosity, because you've got to give, because He outgave you by miles. And here's the thing we see. This Christmas season, I understand that there's some, like, the economy's rough. And I know as you think through this, and we're talking about worship and we're talking about giving, you're like, okay, He's going to talk about something that we got to give, right? True. But here's the thing I want to tell you. In the whole time that we've existed as a church, as New Life Church, like, I've maybe spoke about giving two times. Like, financially. Offering, some of you might be sitting in here going, where's the plate? You haven't passed the plate. We don't even do that. Because really, it's, are you going to give? Are you going to do what God said to do? And so, there's opportunities. You can do it through the app and online. You can do it through the little box back there. But there's really not this thing of like, hey, we're going to pass the plate. Like, it's just not that. Because my heart is, as we've said from the very beginning, that we are people that we give our best. And I know that that's different for each of us. So much so that Jesus even showed us this. He said, Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put. And He watched the crowd putting their money in the temple treasury. Many rich people threw in large amounts. But a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins worth only a few cents. Now today, they'd be worth a little bit more, right? So, calling His disciples to Him, Jesus said, truly I tell you, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than others. I love how Jesus just kind of shocks, like, His first statements are usually just shockworthy, right? Like, for them, they're like, what? Like, did you see the wads of cash or whatever that they put in? Like, no, obviously, they gave the most. But Jesus goes on and He gives it a little bit more clarity. He said, they gave out of their wealth. But she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all that she had to live on. She had a worship, and part of her worship was giving. And she gave with a generosity unlike anybody else. And Jesus pointed it out that she gave more than even the wealthiest person in that room. You see, the widow teaches us a few things. Bigger isn't always better. The Lord looks at the heart. Stop investing in things that don't matter. Kind of simple, right? But so many times we miss the opportunity that's right in front of us. I mean, I've had conversations with people, and mainly people that don't want to give, or don't feel like what the Bible says is really what they're supposed to do. And so they'll argue. They'll argue about Old Testament tithing and whether that's really, like, Jesus came, and so that's all been pushed to the side. And I'm like, okay, so you don't want to give 10%, but you want to do what Jesus tells us to do. Okay. Jesus said give everything. Oh, okay, yeah. You know, like, and then, but usually what it is it's just somebody that's holding their possessions like this. They're holding their talents, their time, a tight fist. And they're not willing to give. Why? Because they're afraid that they're going to lack something. And when we have this understanding, or we have this mindset of where we lack something, then we have a wrong perspective of who God is. Remember, God never changes. And He said He's the one that will supply all of your needs. All of them. David gave us the perfect picture. He said, the Lord is my shepherd. I have everything I need. So if something's out of whack, it's probably in something that's inside of you that you haven't really surrendered yet to God. And so God's looking at you going, you can live like this or you can live like this. I had a great conversation with a young man that just been able to be an influence in his life over the years, and he's trying to figure out what the next step is. He's graduating from college. He's a great, great guy. And, you know, like, we're like, man, it'd be awesome if you came back here. Like, everybody loves you, you know? And he's like, yeah, I've applied for a couple jobs in different places. And he's like, it's hard because I know, like, I can come back here and I can have what I want and I can do what I want. But he goes, I just feel like God is just telling me to approach this all with open hands. And I'm like, man, I wish I could get what the 23-year-old gets. I wish I could understand, like, at times, like, hey, maybe I just need to approach this next decision with open hands just to go, okay, God, I would love to see this happen. And God, I know that this, I mean, here's how we kind of justify things with God. God, I know this can help your kingdom. I know it'll be, like, how many have ever done that? Anybody? Yeah, me too. Okay? But it's this thing of like, okay, God, it's not my will, but your will. So I want to live with open hands. I want to be generous. I want to give not out of my wealth, but out of my poverty, because I'm living with everything given to you and saying, God, however you want to use it, use it. And so this year, this season, as a church, I want to give us a few opportunities. There was a statement that we made in the One at a Time series. And in the One at a Time series, one of the things we said is oftentimes we need to do for one what we wish we could do for everyone, right? And then if you add that to it, and you continue that quote, it says, so that hopefully one day we can do for everyone what we did for the one, right? And so this Christmas season, I want to give us a year-end challenge as a church. And it's a generosity challenge. Now, the first part of it is equal in it at the worship, extravagant or expressive worship. I think every one of us should be like lit up every time we get to sing, every time we get to do all the stuff that we do in here, but more importantly, when we walk out of this place. Because worship is not just the songs we sing, but it's how we live. It's a lifestyle. And I hope that people see you worshiping like in your workplaces. I hope that when they look at you, they say they are the best at their job. Why? Because you're not working for your employer. You're realizing that God is your employer. Right? So that's where we start from. And so we have this expressive worship, but we also have this extravagant generosity. So this year I want to invite you into three different things. As we kind of went through some things, there's some different needs that, you know how sometimes some things are just like, they're right there, we got to do something, and we need to do something now. You ever had those, right? And then there's just some of those other ones where we just put them out there because we know, like, this is what God's doing, and we know that as we move forward, there's needs, there's things that are arising, and we know that during this season, I mean, we want to give. And I know that during this season, you're like, man, I don't know if I have much more to give. Here's what I'm saying to you. Put your hands out, open them up, and go, God, what do you want to do? Because like I said earlier, I know the economy's rough. But if you're looking at this economy, then you're looking at the wrong economy. Because God's economics are completely different than American economics. And so I can tell you story after story. I can bring people up here, line them up, person after person, and they can tell you of stories of how God has met their needs and how God continues to provide for everything they need. As they've stepped out in faith, they didn't know how things were going to happen, and God still did it. And that's all they can explain. It was just God. I don't know how he did it, but that's how God does it. So here's the opportunities. First one is this. We want to provide for a family in need. So we have somebody that comes to church here and their home situation is a little rough. Even so much so that even up to a month ago, they didn't have a bed that they were sleeping on, right? And so we want to give them a Christmas. We want to bless them with the things that they need, some food, some different things like that, some gifts that they can open on Christmas morning. And so that it's just a thing to say, hey, we see you, we love you, right? And so we want to do that for you. And so this is an easy one, and we just kind of put some little numbers by them. They don't really mean anything. I mean, like, we're going to do this, whether you do it or not. Like, that's just what we'll do. But here's the beautiful part. The second one, this week, Blake and I were sitting down, and I'm like, hey, can you call the lady that they know? I said, can you call them and just say, hey, is there anybody that's like behind on rent and they're just struggling right now? Like they can't get their bills caught up. They can't do all this stuff. And immediately, as soon as Blake talks to this lady, she's like, yeah, there's a lady right now. Didn't even hesitate. She didn't go, well, let me think about it. She knew exactly the person and exactly what needed to happen. Yeah. Because she goes, I might lose my job for what I've been doing to make sure that this lady is able to stay in her home. Okay? And what's amazing about it is this, is as we talked, we're like, Blake's like, ask her the number, and I'm like, we can do that. That's not a problem. Like, even if no one gives a penny, we're good, right? But we want to invite people into this moment of generosity. And here's the thing, we don't know the person, but that's okay. You know what the beautiful part about it? We might just get to be a light to them this Christmas season. And it's not going to be, whoa, look at all that New Life Church did for this person. No, it's going to be, look what God did for you. Okay, here's your cries. This lady is struggling. She lost her mother recently. And during this process, she obviously took on all her mother's stuff when she had passed. And in the process, lost the car because she couldn't make payments. And so they came and repossessed the car. But the house that they have, they're kind of just been helping her kind of get through, drag it out just a little bit longer. And so she, though, is dealing with some medical issues, too. Because at this point of trying to get into work and trying to do things, she started passing out. And so they can't figure out why she's passing out, what's happening. And so she just knows that she can't continue to go do these things and then obviously pass out. Like, it's not going to work. And so she's in this process of trying to, if I'm getting this story wrong, Blake, just say you're getting wrong. She's in the process of trying to apply for disability and some assistance to help her through this season so she can figure medical bills out. She's got all kinds of stuff that are just piling up on her at this point. And it's one of those stories where it's just like, in the words of the lady, she just needs a little bit of help to keep her going, right? And so we put this number of 5,000, her bills total right now, like $3,000 is where she's at. In the first service, I had an anonymous gift already of the $3,000. Like, they just said, we'll cover that. I'll actually drop a check off next week, and then we're actually going to give to the other things too. But that's I'm just telling you, that's the heart of the people in this. If you haven't been journeying with us for a long time, that's every time, every need we've ever had, God meets it. From the very beginning, let me just share this really quick. Like, we were going back and forth because in the original core group, I mean, we had people from all different denominations. I mean, from United Brethren to Baptist to Assemblies of God to all these different groups in there. And so we're like, oh, like, man, if we go with this denomination, they'll give us this money. If we do this, we'll do this. You know, and it was like, so we kind of like, okay, we'll journey down this and see what happens. Like, door closed. Journey down this one, door closed. And we're like, well, I guess we're not going to do any denomination. And so from that point, though, we came back to the group and we said, here's the thing. It's all going to be done within here. And so within a matter of a few months, like with a small core group of people who are still here, like we came up with, I think, $35,000 in a short time. And I will tell you this, and Brian can attest to this, and Rick can attest to this, and Joe and Elaine can attest to this. Nobody in that group is independently wealthy. Not. It was all sacrificial. It was all sacrificial. Even the gift that was given, it's sacrificial. I know. But they said, this is what we're supposed to do. This is what we need to do. Now, that's not to detract you from helping, because here's the thing. We know that the journey, like, we can bring her up to, like, even right now, as of December, whatever today is, 4th. But, like, we know that it might be a month or 2 months or 3 months before. I mean, have you ever tried to work with government stuff? Like, yeah, okay, so it could take a while, right? And so we want to give her that little bit of cushion. So whatever comes in, whatever gets allocated to this, we're going to make sure in some way that we help her and we support her. Now, here's what I tell you. I'll tell you this. We take an incredible amount of responsibility when we do these things because we don't want to set somebody up for failure either, right? So, like, the money is not written to this person. The money is actually given to the place where the bill needs to be paid. Now, here's the other thing we do not know. And as we engage in this a little bit, what we may find out is like they might be back on water bills, electric bills, gas bills. We don't know. But we want to really bless this person. She has no connection with us. She knows nothing about this right now. Like tonight, we're having our elder meeting. Brian is going to write a check. We're going to go deliver the first check right away to bring her up to, so they don't take her house away. It's the right thing to do, right? And so we're going to do that. And the third one is simply this, and this is keeping our thoughts moving towards the future and what God is wanting to do on that property at the Adrian Mall. Is January 18th, we have hopefully, will be our final site plan approval for the initial phase of what we're going to do with the church. But it's the city, hopefully, of Adrian will approve the site plan, and then we'll be able to move to close on the building, right? So awesome, great place to be. But we need to get to that place. That's the place we want to get to. That's the place we've been aiming for, is to get that thing in our possession and us own it, okay? And so with that, though, we know that there's other things we need to do in order to continue to move forward. And one of the things is we got to build a wall, right? And the wall is, 130 feet by 16 feet high. And that's not cheap. It was a lot cheaper about 2 years ago when we started this process. But we know God's going to supply. We know that He's going to take care of us. And we estimate like those costs will be somewhere between $25,000 and $30,000. Hopefully not more than that, but who knows with the way everything is. But if you're, my prayer, my request to you is this. Pray about what God asks you to do. Don't pray like this, right? Pray like this. And go, God, what are you asking me to do? What are you asking me to be a part of? Because I was half tempted to go, hey, I'm not going to share that we've covered the initial. Because then for some people, that kind of takes the weight off. And like, okay, somebody else is taking care of it. No, every one of us is going to do our part. Whether it's two small coins or whether it's $200 bills. Like, that's the difference. When everybody does their part, it's beautiful. It's how God wired the church to work. Everybody doing something. And so today, that's what we're inviting you into. That's what we're saying. Hey, let's take this season and let's be expressive in our worship and extravagant with our generosity and see what God does as we end 2022. Would you take a minute? Would you pray with me? Would you do me a favor, just right where you're at, if you can, just tip your hands up and hold them open. Father, this morning we sit here with our hands open, unclenched, not holding to anything, but open to whatever you want to do. God, I know these are just a few things. And my hope is that, God, you would open up our eyes to all the things that are even around us.
Things that we could even meet that need right now. Because sometimes, God, you use me to meet the need. And so, God, as we walk through the hallways of our schools, as we stand in our places of employment, as we work with other people, as we partner with other people, God, may you open up our eyes to see what it is you're asking us to personally do. Because, God, we know that if we just limited it to finances, God, we're missing a part of what you're wanting to do. And so, God, maybe it's spending some time. Maybe it's in a talent that we have or an ability that you've given us that we can use to really help somebody else. God, it's amazing to me how you've wired each and every person. And that, God, you've given some knowledge that, man, some of us are just jealous of. And God, they can work with numbers the way no one else can work with numbers. You've given some in this room just the ability to create. And God, it just blows my mind what people come up with. And I pray that you would use these open hands in whatever way you see fit. whatever way you see fit, to see your kingdom come and your will be done right here in our communities, in our homes, in our workplaces, in this world. God, I'm excited. Christmas isn't about the trees and about even the gifts under the tree. Even though all those things are fun and they're exciting and I truly enjoy those things, Christmas is about Jesus. The most extravagant gift that you could ever give us. And so God, today as we end this time, God, we want to be expressive in our worship, in our songs, in our response to who you are. Because God, we know that in order for you to love us the way that we need to be loved, God, we really truly need to know that you are holy. That there's no one else like you. So today, God, I pray that, Lord, we would just, God, sit in this place. That we would respond in the way that the angels did. We would respond in the way that the shepherds or the magi or Simon or Anna or any of those, that just when they saw Jesus, filled with a heart of gratitude. God, I feel like today, even God, you're offering us freedom. And freedom is going to come through a heart of gratitude. It's going to be us expressing, God, just how thankful we are and how grateful we are for every good and perfect gift that you give us. Expressing, God, because you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. So today, God, may we just see Christmas is about Jesus. And because it's about Jesus, it calls us to a place of expressive worship and extravagant generosity. So God, in this moment that we have left, God, we bring to you our best gift. We give you our best. In Jesus' name.